little, well, Jesus is Lord. That's all. That's all that matters. Jesus is Lord. And so welcome to this morning, this morning's edition of the Water Garden. We're still in this virtual reality. I pray that you all are having a good morning. And listen, and I want you to know this, regardless of what may be going on or what may be going wrong, if you love the Lord, and if you are the called according to his purpose, God has committed himself to doing what needs to be done to see to it that all things will work together for your good. So that's the word of the Lord today, and we'll expound upon that a little more in a few more moments. That's going to be our message for today. But at this time, again, welcome to the Water Garden, and I'm going to turn it over to my wife. I'm going to ask her. This is the first time that we're doing it this way. We are for real this morning. We are one church in two locations. So, okay. Amen. Let's try this again. Praise God. Okay. So, you know what? So let me do this. We're having some technological difficulties, and so and I will not make any excuses. So listen, we are going to go directly into the word, the song that I have prepared for you. There's something going wrong with this, so I just want to go directly into the word. Okay, and this is the bottom line. I don't, you know what, there's just so much going on. Not, oh, you can't hear me. Okay, you all can't hear me. You all are unable. I got a message saying that you can't hear me. If you all can hear me, say, tell me, type, I can hear you. Good morning, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay. Oh, praise God. You can't. Okay. So you all can hear me. Okay. Praise God. Okay. Let me, I don't know what's going on with some of this technology, but let me do this. Let me take control of the atmosphere. And let us we're gonna work with it as long as it, you know, as long as we can. Okay, we're gonna take control of this atmosphere, and we're gonna give God praise today.
People asking you what I got on.
So
they be like, "Hey, Pringle, what you got on? Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. It's too hard. Don't worry."
Invis is everything braces isn't. More comfortable, fewer emergency appointments. Invisalign.
I just wanna praise you, hallelujah. Forever. Blessing me. Oh, yes. Father, sir, I want to thank you for those words this morning. Forever. Hallelujah. For all. Everything you've done for me, blessings and glory. Because he alone is worthy of all of the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise. So we're going to go directly into the word right now. And, you know, this week, within just the last 24 hours, the Lord has just been dealing with me. And I just want to share a very brief but very pertinent word to all of us, wherever we may be. And let me say this to you. If you're not experiencing any chaos in your life, if you're not experiencing any crisis in your life, if you're not experiencing any commotion in your life, all is well, everything is copacetic, then your assignment is to be intentional about interceding for others. Pray for others, because there are so many people right now, present tense, that are going through so much. Amen. And they need the hand of God. They need the divine intervention of God. And as I was processing this, I was contemplating and really focusing on the message that came forth on last week, which was talking about loving God. And as I pondered upon it, and actually I was intentionally pondering upon it, but even when I mentally went away from the message on last week, as I've been here in South Carolina, and I praise God, I thank the Lord for the opportunity to spend some time with my mother, and as I've been here and just processing just life, you know, life is in full session, and just news that was coming in. A very dear friend of mine lost a daughter this week. I want you to know, Mary, we are praying for you. Lost a daughter this week, and as you know, the actor of Black Panther, Chad Brosnan. Please forgive me if I'm botching up the name. I'm not reading any notes or anything like that. but the actor from Black Panther, we know that he passed unexpectedly, very surprisingly to the majority of us, because no one knew the extent of his ailment. But unbeknownst to me, he's actually from the South Carolina area, and he's actually a relative of an in-law to one of my closest cousins. So I didn't even know that. And so we were talking, and they were sharing some things with me about that. And so people are experiencing losses on a myriad of levels, and we're experiencing losses and crosses and causes of great stress, great struggle, and great strain. And as I began to just mentally process that, the word of God, I just heard this word that and I want to read it verbatim, because a lot of times we make reference to scripture, and because we are familiar with the scripture, we may we kind of take literary license, and we say things that the word actually didn't say, or we will have different contexts that the word is not actually saying. This is why the Bible says that we are to rightly divide the word of truth. This is why the Bible tells us, he said, do not add, don't add to it. So we are to do right division. Okay, so we want to rightly divide the word of truth. And what I heard in my spirit this week, the scripture that we know that is found in Romans, the 8th chapter and the 28th verse. And it reads, and we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Now, many times we make reference to this scripture, and we kind of use it as a catch-all scripture. We use it as just a blanket statement. And so whenever someone is going through something, or they're confronted with a challenge, then this is our knee-jerk response. Well, you know, all things work together. All things work together for the good. And usually we will even abbreviate the scripture to that extent. We'll just say, well, you know, all things work together for good. All things work together for good. And let me tell you, unfortunately, that is not what this particular passage of scripture is implying, inferring, or indicating. It is not just a one size fit all. There are some specific conditions that this scripture clearly indicates when he makes the statement, and we know all things work together for good. That precipitates the two conditions. Somebody say terms and conditions. Somebody say, and I'm going to give you my topic in a moment, but I'm just doing the setup right now. There are terms and conditions that must be met. And we know all things work together for good. Okay, that is the guarantee. That is what's being promised. That is what's being presented to us. That is what God is saying. This is how it's going to pan out. It's going to work together for the good, condition number one, to them that love God, number one. And then two, to them who are the called, who are the called according to his purpose. And let's be clear about this. The called according to his purpose are those who respond to the call. Because many are called, but few are chosen. In other words, few have chosen to respond to the call. How many times have you ignored a call? How many times have you sent a call to voicemail? How many times have you declined a call? So just because you are called doesn't mean that there has been a response. You have the opportunity, and you have the right to respond or not respond. And many of us, in many instances and in many areas of our lives, we have not, or we are not responding to the call. And so now this is a very, very, very vast subject. And certainly I cannot adequately and accurately deal with it in the limited amount of time that we have today. So we're just going to float that balloon and we'll pull it down some other time in another Bible study or another service. What I want to focus on today for just a few moments is the first part of the condition, the first term. The first term and the first condition that I want to deal with, those that love God. Now remember last week we talked about loving God and we spent a lot of time expounding upon that. I took longer on last Sunday than I had initially intended to. But loving God is a critical thing. We shared how that loving God according to scripture is the greatest commandment. The greatest commandment. And hear what I'm saying. Loving God is not a suggestion. It's not just a counsel. It is not just something that we're advised to do. It is not a recommendation. It is not something that, oh, you might want to try loving God. The Bible says that loving God, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and one of the translations even includes, and with all your strength. With your effort, you got to put something in it, okay? What we have to say, so loving God, all things work together with those who love God. Let's look at John chapter number 14. And I want to look at verse number 23 because we don't get to choose how we love God and expect for God to accept it. We do serve a God who does exercise his right and his option to reject what we offer him. Well, I got scripture to back me up. From the very beginning, the Bible said that God had no respect for the offering that Cain offered him. That is in the book. Don't have time to go to it. Go to Genesis, read it for yourself. Just because we offer it does not mean God honors it. It's the truth. How many times have you received a gift, whether it was a physical gift or whether it was a sentiment that didn't rub you the right way, if you will? Wasn't something that you liked, that you appreciated? You didn't have any, it just did not resonate with you. Now, you may not have said anything to the giver of it, but I'm just asking, how many times has something been given to you? And if you have not literally and actually had this experience, I just want you to wrap your mind around the concept that it is absolutely possible for you to be presented with something, whether it's a word, whether it's a song, whether it's a gift, whether or not it's something tangible, but it did not give you that warm, fuzzy feeling because it wasn't something that you desired. And many times, this is what we're doing as it pertains to the love that we're offering to God, the worship that we're offering to God. This is why I love what David said. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. God, let you be pleased. See, let me not be so narcissistic. Let me not be so self-absorbed into thinking that because I'm doing what I want to do and what I like to do and what I want to give him, that this is the thing that that he's pleased with. God clearly, and I'm just going to give one scripture today that where God clearly articulates that he has an expectation as it pertains to the kind of love that he wants. Like he qualifies the love. In John chapter number 14, verse number 23. Now let's look at one of the qualifiers. The Bible says, Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. Now, do you see the correlation, the connection, the collaboration between the promise that we were given in Romans, the 8th chapter and the 28th verse, it tells us, for we know all things work together for the good of them who love God. Because if you love God the way that God has described love in John 14 and 23, where he says, if you love me, you will keep my words. So I love God, and as and what proves, what supports and substantiates my claim that I love God is that I'm making the effort to keep his word. And as a result of me keeping his word, Jesus says that the Father will love him. My Father, his Father, God, my Father, our Father is going to love us. And we, who is we? God and Jesus, the whole Godhead, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. They will come and do what? We will come unto him and make our abode. So this is the precedent as to how and why all things work together for those who love God. Because when you love God, God says that we, Jesus says, we will make our abode. So now, when God lives somewhere, when God dwells somewhere, when God abides somewhere, everything that is out of order has to come into order. Everything that is in conflict has to come into a cohesive existence. This is how, glory to God, this is why, glory to God, not some things, not most things, not many things, but all things are working together for those who love God. I'll deal with called according to his purpose at another time. Today, we just want to let that sink in, that Father God, you have given me a promise. Hey, you've given me your word that I don't care how out of order, I don't care how dysfunctional, I don't care how much commotion, how chaotic, whatever the situation, whatever the circumstance may be, if I am loving God, hey, that all things, even that thing, yeah, that thing too, is going to work together. It's coming together for my good. It doesn't look like it. It doesn't look like the pieces fit. It doesn't look like this thing is going to work out. It doesn't look like I'm going to have a positive outcome. But the Bible says that we know it. We know it, that you are going to come into a knowing. And when it talks about knowing, that word knowing, knowing is not just about a mental or intelligent comprehension of the subject matter. That is one extent. That is one context of knowing. But knowing also means having a personal experience. Like the Bible says, and Adam knew Eve, and like Abraham knew Sarah. Come on here. That is about an intimacy. That is about a real personal, a real profound coming into. The Bible talks about people who are always hearing the truth but never coming into the knowledge of it. This is the season that God wants us to come into the knowledge of what it means for not him loving us, because that's a settled. That's forever settled. That's a settled fact. The Bible says, and he said, Paul said, for I am persuaded that nothing shall be able to separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. That is God's love towards us. That it has already been established. That can never be severed. We can never be severed from the love of God. The question is, do you love him? And how much do you love him? Do you love him enough to keep his word? Because when we love God, we will be keepers of his word. Help us, God, more love to thee, O Christ. That needs to be our prayer today. Our prayer today needs to be, Father, teach me. Teach me how to love you. Teach me. Everybody needs to be loved. Even God. That doesn't make God weak. That doesn't make God human. God is still altogether lovely. He's still all powerful. He's still almighty. He's still omnipotent. All of that. But when it comes to this subject matter, when it comes to this issue of love, God even has requirements. And so we need to ask God today, hey, God, teach me, Father. Teach me how to love you. Teach me how to keep your word. Teach me, because I want to experience you coming in and making your abode in my life. Because where God is, darkness cannot dwell. He dispels darkness in whatever form that it is seeking to manifest it in its life. We need to ask God today, God, teach me. So I don't care. Somebody got some bad news this week. Somebody walked up on some type of some surprises, some things that have that have upset some things. Oh, glory to God.
So the whatever may have happened. And let me just be transparent for a moment. I had some things that just happened in the past few days, but I'm telling you, the word of the Lord came to me. Desmond, all things work together. Before you even allow your emotions, to be rattled, before you even allow yourself to be drawn into frustration, before you even do any of that, take possession of your soul by taking comfort in the word that is coming to you, that's telling you, you are going to know that all things work together for your good. And when that, and even all of those words that are in that one sentence, that things work, it lets us know again, that this is not a blanket statement. It is a system. There is a system to love. There is a system to it. There is a system to things working or functioning. There is a way that things operate. It is not just any and everything goes. So this is why we've got to zero in, dial down on what it really means to love God so that we can be the benefactors of the benefits that he has already downloaded, that he has already included, that he has already engineered into this love thing. This love thing with God is not something that's just frivolous. It's not something that's just a bunch of feelings. God wants us to experience a real interaction and a real exchange with him today. Are you hearing me? I don't care what's going on in your life. There is no challenge that has confronted you today. My sisters and my brothers, hear me. Hear what I'm saying. There's nothing. It's news to you, but it's not news to God. And before you start to worry, God is already concerned. He sees the end at the beginning. It's the beginning of a thing to you, but God has already orchestrated the ending. Why? Because our steps are ordered by God. But the way that we're going to be in lockstep with the orders of God is by being a people who are constantly, consistently working on our love life. Because when we put forth the effort to be in a real, healthy love life with God, we will never be a people who will be the victim, who will be shortchanged, and who will have the experience of having an unrequited love, a love that has no response. God is not some jack leg lover. Are you hearing me? He's not the kind of lover that's going to leave you jilted. He's not the kind of lover who's going to break your heart. He is not the kind of lover who's going to misuse you, abuse you, confuse you. He's not the kind of lover that is going to use you. That is not who he is. God is faithful and just. And this is why all things are going to work out for you, because the God that you serve, the God that you're loving, has your best interests at heart all the time. Even if the situation or the directive or the instructions that he may be giving you in this season, they may be uncomfortable, they may be undesirable, but know that he is not punishing you. This is not a punitive process. Are you hearing me, people of God? We've got to relax and we've got to rely on the unadulterated truth that the God that we love, the God that we serve, the God that we're praying to, the God that we're calling on, the God that we are loving on is committed to all of this working out for our good. And I'm telling you, if we would find consolation in that. And when I say consolation, I'm not talking about, listen, let your feelings be hurt for a moment. See, we always want to feel the thing. Sometimes you're not going to feel the way that you want to feel. Love is not just about affection. It's not about the warm, fuzzy feeling. Love is about an action. There are things to do. And sometimes the things that you need to do are not the things that you want to do. But love calls for it. Hallelujah. And so today we need to ask God, teach me how to love you. Teach me how to love you, not just in my words, but on your terms, giving you the love that you deserve on your terms. Remember, his thoughts are not my thoughts. His ways are not my ways. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so are his thoughts. But he said what? But if you seek me, he said, come on, get on my level. Come learn how to love on my level. I'm here and you might be here, but you don't have to stay that way. When we seek to love God, when we seek to be in harmony and in unity with his word, hey, we then become on the rise. We become on the rise. And then our love meets his love. And what a great love affair. What a great love experience. And this is how the consequences and the repercussions of the actions that we take, because they will have been in lockstep with his divine will, because we have told him, not my will, but thy will be done. When his will becomes our will, when our thoughts become agreeable with his will, then our plans will be established, the scripture says, and they will succeed. Why? Because then we will have engaged and embraced, glory to God, what it really means to experience all things working together, no longer separate, no longer your way, his way, a way, no, the way. Specificity. We've got to be a people who are going to become passionate about being in the specificity. God is very specific. God is not random. I know that we live in a very random world. We live in a very fluid world. You know, you do your way. That is not God. That is not scripture. And don't let the ways of the world, don't get drunk with the wine of the world. This is a season that you must insist on being sober, because the world is sophisticated. The world is intelligent. The world is strategic, and it all appeals to the flesh. It all seems to make sense, but it makes sense. Are you hearing me? It separates us from God. It separates us from the principles, the policies, and the precedents of God. It does. Now, and let me tell you something. We are officially, effectively in the season, in the era, in the moment of the great falling away. It has already begun. Those days that were talked about as if there were some prophetically futuristic, far in the distant future. No, sir. No, ma'am. Those days are here. The Antichrist, the spirit of the Antichrist, he is no longer coming. He's here. And so this is the season, the hour, the moment, the day, the time that let God be true and every man a liar. I don't care how influential or affluential he or she may be. God, choose ye this day whom ye will serve. Choose ye this day whom you're going to love. Choose ye this day on whom you're going to set your affection. And then choose ye this day upon whom you're going to take the action steps to pursue. I choose to pursue God today. And I'm encouraging you, my brothers and my sisters, fall in love with Jesus. Get in love with Jesus. Not just emotionally, not just affectionately, but actually in our actions, And it's not comfortable to the flesh. So forget about convenience and comfortability. We're focusing on conformity. We're focusing on compliance. When we talk about love, see, this is why people can't stay married. Because when you stop feeling the warm, fuzzy butterflies, and let me tell you something, when it gets down to the two becoming one, that you're working on that oneness, glory to God, it's not always comfortable. It's not always convenient, because we are two individuals that come from two totally different individual experiences. And we're merging to become one life. And that is how it is with the people of God. That's why you're considered the bride of Christ. Come here, bride. He's the husbandman. We're the bride. And church, guess what? He's got it together. We've got to work on coming together so that we can be together. Glory to God. This is what the love of God, this is what the love of God is wanting us to experience, the love of God, the love of God. And so, people of God, so my topic for today, as I come to my conclusion, we're talking about loving God, but the loving God is a kind of love with benefits. That's all I wanted to share today. A love with benefits. A love with benefits. I want to say that again. Loving God is a love with benefits. And guess what? You're the benefactor. I'm the benefactor. And one of the greatest benefits, one of the greatest benefits, not the only, but one of the greatest benefits is that all things work together for my good because I love God. Well, people of God, that's the word for today. Our broadcast was a little different today. My wife, we didn't get to do some of what we usually do. We thought we had the technology mastered, but anyway, I don't want to make any excuses, but it is what it is. But the word went forth, and that's the most important thing. That's the most important thing. But she's on. She is on. And I pray right now. So let us pray. Father God, in Jesus' name, we just give you glory and honor and praise for this day that you have made. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word is life. Father, we thank you that your word gives light. The entrance of your word gives light. And so, Father, as we open ourselves up to you to not only receive and experience your love, Father, we open ourselves and by faith and with great expectation, we receive the glorious light that comes along with you. Father, expose all of the darkness in our lives, all of the dark places, all of the dark areas. Father, all of the dark passions, all of the dark motives, all of the dark intentions. Father, let the glorious light of yourself radiate, beam, and shine in our souls, Father, that we will be a people who are, that we will walk as children of the light. In the name of Jesus. God, not only as it pertains to people seeing us and how people seeing us, Father, but even when there's no one watching and when there's no one around, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would cause us to be a people who are walking in the light, who are living in the light, who are sleeping in the light, the glorious light of your gospel, the glorious light of your presence. Hallelujah, Father, in the name of Jesus, may we come today to experience what it really means to love you, Father. Hallelujah. God, we sit and we silence our souls. We still our souls, our emotions and our thoughts and our feelings and desires that are so prone to get wound up, that are so prone to become frustrated and irritated and aggravated and even concerned and disturbed and anxious about things that we don't even have control over. Father, we thank you right now, Father, that you will teach us, that you will enable us, that you will strengthen us to just be a people who are resting in the love of God, not only in your love for us, but in our love for you, being participants and partakers of your divine nature, because you are love. You are love, for God is love. And so we thank you today. We thank you today. We thank you today for this great benefit. We thank you that it's not just a fringe benefit. It is an intentional. It's an intentional benefit. We're not just on the fringes. It's not just something that just we might get a little bit of. God, we thank you, God, that we can be fully vested in the love of God, fully vested, Father, today in the name of Jesus. And we call this done in Jesus' name, in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. We give God honor. We give God praise because he is good and he loves us. He loves us. Oh, how he loves you and me. I wish I could sing a song today, but this, amen. Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Well, my time is up. Okay. Well, I want to do a favor. We're going to confess the favor of God, and we're going to conclude with the favor, because let me tell you something, people of God,
You need to know beyond any shadow of doubt that the favor of God, it is what he gives to us of his own volition. We can't negotiate it. We cannot barter or bargain for it. Whether it's nothing that you do to earn it. You don't deserve it. God gives it to us. What a wonderful thing. So when we talk about and we confess, make this confession of favor, this is not just something to take up space. It's not just something that we do because it's a sermon filler. We believe passionately and emphatically in the favor of God. So in Jesus' name today, we're going to turn it over to my wife. Honey, I want you to do the confession of favor and you know, share this on your heart. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Well, this is the end of service, but before we leave, as my husband said, we're going to confess the favor of God in our lives, and we confess it with power, purpose, and passion. In the name of Jesus, I am the righteousness of God. Therefore, I am entitled to covenant kindness and covenant favor. The favor of God is among the righteous. The favor of God surrounds the righteous. Therefore, it surrounds me everywhere I go, in everything I do, and I expect the favor of God to be in manifestation. Never again will I be without the favor of God. It rests richly upon me. It profusely abounds in me, and I am part of the generation that is experiencing it immeasurably, limitlessly, and surpassingly. Therefore, favor produces supernatural increase, promotion, restoration, honor, increased assets, greater victories, recognition, prominence, preferential treatment, petitions granted, policies and rules changed, and battles won in which I do not have to fight. Favor is on me and it goes before me. Therefore, my life will never be the same. This is the year of God's favor in my life. And that is the favor of God in Jesus' name. Amen. I tell you, walk in God's favor this week. Expect God's favor. And now we're looking for a miracle.
I'm looking for a miracle. I expect the impossible. Feel the impossible. I see the invisible. I'm looking for a miracle. I expect the impossible. I feel the impossible. I see the invisible. There is no limit to what I can have. There is no limit to what I can have. There is no limit to what I can have. Just believe and receive it. God will perform it today. Hey, hey, believe and receive it. God will perform it today. Hey.
Honey, do you have a thought for the day?
Well, the thought for today is when we believe in the miracles of God, when we trust in his promises, it's just these words. Everyone will know it was God. So those are the things that we are expecting. Those are the things that we're believing for, that man won't get credit. The parents won't get credit. The spouses won't get credit, but it's going to be so dynamic that everyone will know it was God. Those are the kind of miracles I'm believing God for, that they will know only God do it. Only God did it in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Amen. I believe it's a scripture that says, and they shall say God did it. Yes. So we thank God for his intervention and his providence. So, well, praise God. I believe that Minister Yuri had the opportunities and the way to give, ways to give. They should be on the screen. Thank you so much for joining us. We declare and decree the blessing of the Lord upon you this week and beyond. As a matter of fact, for the rest of your lives, may the grace and peace and sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you. Henceforth now, may he bless you. You're going out, you're coming in, you're uprising, and you're downsetting in Jesus' name. And I want to say this before we leave, that if you have not made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, it's very simple. The Bible says that if you would confess with your mouth, you make this verbal confession that you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. And he said, if you make that confession and you believe in your heart that he did, that you shall be saved. It is just that simple. And after that initial salvation experience, you are to just grow in the grace of God. Grow in the grace of God, and just day by day. So if you say this prayer with me. Father, in Jesus' name, I acknowledge today that I believe that Jesus died for my sins, and I believe that you raised him up on the third day, and I confess that I believe this with my mouth, and by faith I receive salvation. I thank you, Father, for saving me. If you have said that prayer with me today, I want you to know, regardless of how you feel or may not feel, regardless if there's a whole lot of hoopla or not, it's not based on feelings. It is based on the fidelity and the integrity of God's word. He is committed. He's a covenant-keeping God. That's what he says. And so it works. You are saved. Welcome into the body of Christ. And so if you did go through that little brief but very powerful exercise this morning, please reach out to us by way of maybe either one of these Facebook pages, or you may reach us by way of email. Our email address is contact@thewgf.info. So reach out to us this week, and we will be more than excited and happy to respond to you and work with you. All right. Well, Jesus is Lord. Until next week, you be blessed of the Lord. God bless you.